In this section, we're going to talk about the foundations for demand. Here we're going to get a little bit deeper into preference and choice, and really getting into why is it the demand curve slopes downward. So as an overview, first we're going to talk about the action axiom, which is really the foundation, I would argue, for economic science. Secondly, we'll turn toward choice and preference and how these relate then to action. And finally, we will derive demand using those things we've learned. So first, the action axiom, what it is, it's simply the statement or the claim that humans act. That is, to expand a little bit, by humans act we mean that humans act purposefully. That is, we get purposes in our mind and we do things to try to achieve them. As simple as, say, feeling thirsty, wanting to sate our thirst, and therefore we take a drink of water. There I'm doing something with a purpose, or it's human behavior that is purposeful. We could expand this a little bit to get at some component ideas. That is, that humans apply means to attain ends according to ideas. That is, that we have some ends available that we'd like to try to achieve, right? I'd like to sate my thirst. We have some means at our disposal that we can use in order to try to achieve that goal, the water that's sitting here next to me, and we have an idea that the two are connected. Now, one point that I would make is that it is perfectly possible that our ideas are totally loony. After all, I might have, say, in mind the end that I would like to be in Costa Rica enjoying a wonderful day on the beach, and I might have the means at disposal of, say, flapping my arms, right? And I have an idea in my mind that if I flap my arms, I will in fact take off like a bird and fly toward Costa Rica where I can land on the beach and enjoy a day there. And naturally my idea here is nutty, but when I start flapping my arms, that's not action. It is actually totally fitting our definition for action. We are applying means in order to attain ends according to some idea connecting them. In this case, we're going to be unsuccessful, and it is perfectly possible for an action to be unsuccessful. That is, for it not to achieve the end that it is attempting to achieve. Now, the source of the action axiom, it ends up, this is something that we can really rely on. It's something that, in fact, must be true, that we cannot even argue against. The reason we know that is that any attempt to disprove the action axiom is, in fact, a performative contradiction. A performative contradiction is something where the performance of attempting to disprove it contradicts the thing that is trying to be disproved. Now, for example, if I make the claim I do not exist, right, simply making this claim proves, in fact, that I do exist. Right? That is, the original thing, that is, I do exist, is proven by the fact that I am here to claim that I do not exist. So the claim that I do not exist is a performative contradiction. That is, it cannot possibly be true for me to make that claim. Similarly, any attempt to disprove the action axiom is in fact an action. That is, you have a goal that you want to achieve, you have some kind of ends, you have a means, your argument that you'd like to use to achieve it, and you have an idea that the two are connected. So any attempt to disprove the action axiom is itself an action, and this actually proves that humans do act. And I suppose this does leave open the possibility that perhaps a computer or a Martian could try to disprove the action axiom without running into a performative contradiction, but we are not yet at the point where we would have to be worried about that. Now that means that the action axiom then is an undeniable truth. That is, any attempt to deny it in fact proves its truth. So it is a truth that cannot be denied, at least not with logical consistency. Now, one of the implications that arises out of the action axiom is that only individuals act. Since acting requires ideas to be part of the composite, we know that ideas must exist in individual minds. Now, naturally, that doesn't mean that you and I never think alike. That's very well possible. But for us to act as a group, what we really have to have is a bunch of individuals that have adopted the same ends and accepted the same ideas about the means that can be used to achieve those ends. So group action, really we need to think of as being a composite of individual actions. If any individual in the group decides not to go along with it, then we don't actually get that action taking place. Now, one caution here is that not all behavior is action. So just because you see somebody performing some kind of behavior, it does not mean that they are acting in the sense that we mean it here. After all, there are lots of things that I do, say, purely out of habit, where I don't actually have any idea in mind, where there are there's some kind of end I'm trying to achieve and some means that I'm using to achieve it. That being the case, if there is no idea connecting means and ends, and no use of means to try to achieve those ends, then we wouldn't say that that behavior is action. So anything that, say, is a reflex, I'd say the grand majority of habits also fall into this case, where it's a behavior that is not really an action. As such, that would mean that these are largely placed outside the study of economics. Economics, really, we should think of as being the study of action, not necessarily the study of behavior, which would be one part of, say, the broader category of psychology. Now turning toward choice and preference. One way that we can think of action is that it's really a choosing between imagined futures. That is, I can imagine a future in which I don't perform a particular action, and my end is therefore not achieved, or at least less likely to be achieved. Meanwhile, I can also imagine another future in which I do undertake a particular action to move me toward that end that I would like to achieve. Now, we can make this very, very simple. Suppose that I'm thinking of ordering food at McDonald's. So I'm standing here in line at the fast food restaurant. I'm looking at the plethora of choices that are made available to me, and I really narrow it down to three. I could get the Big Mac, I could get Chicken McNuggets, or I could get a McFishwich, or whatever they call the fish sandwich there. Now, I only have enough money to buy one of the three, so I have to choose between them. So I imagine, what is my future going to be like in a few minutes? When I'm eating a Big Mac, how will I feel? When I'm eating Chicken McNuggets, how would I feel then? When I'm eating a McFishwich, how would I feel then? So we compare these different imagined futures, and then we choose the one that we happen to like best. Now we can think of doing this process as putting things onto what we call a value scale, or a preference scale, or a value ranking, or a preference ranking. These are all terms for the same thing. Really, it's just an ordered list where we put the most desirable thing on top, second most desirable underneath, third most below that, and so on. So in this case, let's suppose that when I reflect upon these different imagined futures, eating these different foods, I say, well, I would really most like to live in a world where I'm eating a Big Mac than a world where I'm eating McNuggets or McFishwich. But given the choice between McNuggets and McFishwich, I'd rather have the McNuggets. So we have here a well-ordered set. First, the Big Mac, second, Chicken McNuggets, and finally, the McFishwich. And then when I have my choice to take just one of these, it is obvious, looking at the value scale, that I will choose the top one, that is, the Big Mac. Now, the nice thing about the value scale is that it brings into mind opportunity cost. Remember, opportunity cost is what you give up, that is the cost, when you take an opportunity. So in this case, the opportunity cost when I take that Big Mac would be the Chicken McNuggets. Now note here, your opportunity cost is the best option that you don't take. So in this case, if I took the Big Mac, that leaves the McNuggets and the McFishwich not taken. So the McNuggets would then be my opportunity cost. Another point is that it is not all the other options added together. My choice is not between having a Big Mac or having McNuggets and a McFishwich. I only get one of those three things. So it ends up, in reality, the McFishwich was really never in the running. I was either going to get the Big Mac or the Chicken McNuggets. McFishwich was out altogether. That being the case, the only thing I'm really giving up when I take the Big Mac is the Chicken McNuggets. That's what I would have done had I not chosen the Big Mac. So that's another way we can think of opportunity cost. Your opportunity cost is what you would have done if you didn't do what you did. That is, after all, what you're giving up when you take the opportunity that you do take. Choice is also tied up with the idea of scarcity. Scarcity is one of the fundamental economic realities that we face. Scarcity and choice, I just want to point out, these two are very closely interconnected. Now first, when we talk about scarcity in the economic sense, all we really mean is that not everyone can have everything that they would like. That is, that there are some of us that are going to have to go without some of the things that we would like. In fact, I would suggest that virtually all of us have something that we would like to have that we do not in fact have. At the moment, I would like to have, say, my yard be mown, but I haven't had time to do so, I haven't had the energy to do so, so it's something that I don't have at the moment. As long as there's anything out there that someone would like to have that they do not have, we would say that scarcity exists. Now this is interconnected with choice in this way. First, the existence of scarcity requires us to make choices. That is, the reality is we can't all have everything we would like to have, which means we have to make some choices. In my case, I only have a certain amount of time and a certain amount of energy, and I've decided that Using it to mow my lawn is not, in fact, the most important thing right now. I have to make a choice, and that ends up being not chosen, and I choose to do other things. But at the same time, the fact that we do make choices, and we know that this is true that we make choices, that suggests we must live in a world of scarcity. After all, if we didn't live in a world of scarcity, we would never really have to choose between anything. We would just have everything handed to us, and we would never actually feel any need to act. We wouldn't have to pursue any ends, because all of our ends would already be achieved. Another way of saying this is that when we choose, every choosing is at the same time a not choosing for something else. When I choose to eat the Big Mac, I'm choosing not to eat the McNuggets or the McFishwich. Another point is that preference is manifest in our action. That is, action proves the existence of preference. In action, there can't be any indifference. That is, we have to have a preference between things anytime we choose between them. We can't be indifferent between them. Now, on the other hand, that doesn't mean that emotionally we can't be indifferent. For example, whether or not I wear a white or a blue shirt, I don't think my day is going to be absolutely marvelous if I wear a white shirt or absolutely terrible if I wear a blue shirt. I'm really emotionally relatively indifferent. But at the same time, if I have to make a choice between them, I still establish a preference, and on that preference I base my action when I choose. In the next section, we will take all of this and we will, trust me, get to a derivation of demand.